I Trust me. It starts with greetings from Paul. This letter is from Paul, a prisoner for preaching the good news about Christ Jesus, and from our brother Timothy. I am writing to Philemon, our beloved co-worker, and to our sister Aphia, and to our fellow soldier Archippus, and to the church that meets in your house. May God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ give you grace and peace. I always thank God when I pray for you, Philemon, because I keep hearing about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all of God's people. And I'm praying that you will put into action the generosity that comes from your faith as you understand and experience all the good things we have in Christ. Your love has given me much joy and comfort, my brother, for your kindness has often refreshed the hearts of God's people. That is why I am boldly asking a favor of you. I could demand it in the name of Christ, because it is the right thing for you to do. But because of our love, I prefer simply to ask you. Consider this as a request from me, Paul, an old man, and now a prisoner for the sake of Christ Jesus. I appeal to you to show kindness to my child Onesimus. I became his father in the faith while here in prison. Onesimus hasn't been of much use to you in the past, but now he is very useful to both of us. I am sending him back to you, and with him comes my own heart. I wanted to keep him here with me while I am in the chains for preaching the good news, and he would have helped me on your behalf, but I didn't want to do anything without your consent. I wanted to help because you were willing, not because you were forced. It seems like you lost Onesimus for a little while so that you could have him back forever. He is no longer like a slave to you. He is more than a slave, for he is a beloved brother, especially to me. Now he will mean much more to you, both as a man and as a brother in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge it to me. I, Paul, write this with my own hand. I will repay it, and I won't mention that you owe me your very soul. Yes, my brother, please do me this favor. For the Lord's sake, give me this encouragement in Christ. I am confident as I write this letter that you will do what I ask and even more. One more thing, please prepare a guest room for me, for I am hoping that God will answer your prayers and let me return to you soon. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends you his greetings, so do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my co-workers. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit.
It's all of you, it's all I need. You guys want to turn in your Bibles to Psalm 103. I will eventually try to make my way back to the book of Philemon. I promise I'll try. But first, I want to share with everybody what was going on with me this past week and a half. How Jesus was operating when he was giving me this message. So, probably like a year ago. Well, first of all, when I was 17, I was playing basketball and got elbowed right in the mouth. And my tooth broke. And when I grew up, my parents would always get mad if I got hurt because it cost money. So I was trying not to tell them, but it only lasted like a day because it hurt bad. Nerves were exposed. So I had this implant, right? They pulled the tooth out, I got an implant. So it lasted for a while. It was like 25 years, that thing was solid. And then I was in a crisis meeting last year, and we were talking, you know, the spirit was moving, tooth fell right out, right in my lap. Steve-O looked at me, was laughing. I had to go back, it's this one right here. I had to go back and get it fixed. And so the other day, like a week ago, I woke up in the morning, I was sitting on the couch, sneezed real bad, tooth went flying right out. Took me a while to find that thing. I found it was laying on the floor. I was like, all right, let me put it in a baggie. And I was driving to the dentist. Here we go again, like looking like a hillbilly, you know, which that's what I am. But as I was driving, Jesus was like, when you get there, you're going to tell him that tooth fell out because of your sin. So I was like, all right. What a great opportunity. I don't even like to go to the dentist, obviously. So I get there, and a lady comes over, and she's looking at my mouth. You know, I got the tooth in a bag on the counter. And she's like, oh, you got some other issues in there. I was like, yeah. So what an opportunity. I was like, I made some pretty bad choices for about 40-some years of my life. Was a drug addict. And that was like the least of my problems. You know what I mean? I had a sin issue. And I needed a savior. And I said, so my tooth's still messed up. I was like, but my heart's a lot better, you know. And she didn't know what to say. She just looked at me and she was like, well, good for you. And walked out. But I think because I was faithful in doing that, what happened on the ride home was I experienced the presence of Jesus. And I was listening to this song. And I was just recognizing all the things that we are able to experience from being in the presence of Jesus. And then I had these moments of discipleship at the house that week too with Jay and Brian. And Jesus just kept giving us opportunities to be in his presence. And it was so good that I came to this realization maybe for the first time that if I'm not in the presence of Jesus, I ain't really much different than this world. Because I spent a long, long time in my life not experiencing his presence because I wasn't looking for it. So I want to read Psalm 103 and then I want to pray because it captures a lot of things that we're going to talk about today. I'm going to talk about some specific benefits of being in his presence. All these things are a part of salvation. All these things for those who call Jesus Lord are things that they've experienced, and we should continue to expect to experience these things. I want to look at a couple scriptures where Jesus knows that his disciples, well, they're going to be in real trouble if he leaves and they don't get to experience his presence. I want to look at how Moses recognized it clearly too. And then I want to talk about if we have the ability to recognize that other people need to be in his presence. And then maybe at that point we'll get back to Philemon. So let me read Psalm 103 and then I'll pray. It says, "Let all that I am praise the Lord. With my whole heart, I will praise his holy name. Let all that I am praise the Lord. May I never forget the good things he does for me. He forgives all my sins, and he heals all my diseases. He redeems me from death and crowns me with love and tender mercies. He fills my life with good things, and my youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord gives righteousness and justice to all who are treated unfairly. He revealed his character to Moses and his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and merciful. He's slow to get angry and filled with unfailing love. He will not constantly accuse us nor remain angry forever. And he does not punish us for all our sins. He does not deal harshly with us as we deserve. For his unfailing love towards those who fear him is as great as the heights of the heavens above the earth. He has removed our sins as far from us as the east is from the west. The Lord is like a father to his children, tender and compassionate to those who fear him. For he knows how weak we are. He remembers we are only dust. Our days on earth are like grass, like wild flowers we bloom and die. The wind blows and we are gone, as though we had never been there. But the love of the Lord remains forever with those who fear him. His salvation extends to the children's children, of those who are faithful to his covenant, of those who obey his commandments. The Lord has made the heavens his throne. From there he rules over everything. Praise the Lord, you angels, you mighty ones who carry out his plan, listening for each of his commands. Yes, praise the Lord, you armies of angels who serve him and do his will. Praise the Lord, everything he has created, everything in all his kingdom. Let all that I am praise the Lord." Jesus, I know that I say this to you a lot, but man, I'm in awe of the experience that I've had with being in relationship with you. When I think back just a couple, 2.5 short years ago, and then I look at today, and there is no doubt, Jesus, that only you could have done what you did. The scripture reminds us of how quickly our lives are. They start and they end. But in the middle, Jesus, in the middle is your presence. So I thank you. I thank you for your perfect plan of revealing yourself to us in a heart that's hard to understand, that you would desire that we know you. Jesus, you knew me. You knew me very well. And you loved me in spite of it. And you knew everyone in this room. And you still love them. So this is all for you. I pray that you give me the ability, Jesus, to speak clearly. And you give your church the ability to understand. And it's in your name I pray. Amen. All right, so I'm going to talk about some specific benefits of being in the presence of Jesus. And the first one I want to bring to our attention is forgiveness. And as I go through these, let me see. I got 7 different benefits of being in the presence of Jesus. If you in this room have experienced this from being in the presence of Jesus, let me see your hands. Who's experienced forgiveness? All right, almost everybody, okay? It wouldn't be available if it wouldn't have been found in the presence of the King. Everyone that raised their hand can look forward to continually experiencing forgiveness. I want to look at Psalm 32. I'm going to look at what the Bible says about these benefits. This is some scripture that probably is familiar to a lot of us, but this is what the Word of God says about forgiveness. Psalm 32, starting in verse 1. I'm going to read 5 verses. It says, "Oh, what joy for those whose disobedience is forgiven, whose sin is put out of sight. Yes, what joy for those whose record the Lord has cleared of guilt, whose lives are lived in complete honesty. When I refused to confess my sin, my body wasted away, and I groaned all day long. Day and night, your hand of discipline was heavy on me. My strength evaporated like water in the summer heat. But finally, I confessed all my sins to you and stopped trying to hide my guilt. I said to myself, I will confess my rebellion to the Lord, and you forgave me, and all my guilt is gone." So let me ask you this, for everybody that raised their hands and said that they had experienced forgiveness, are you also experiencing the joy that's supposed to come with it? How about the guilt? Has it been removed? Because these things should be lining up. This is the Word of God. Listen, man, forgiveness, this is what I spent some time looking up. Man, what does it mean when Jesus says he forgives you? Well, what I came up with was he lets go of his view of sin towards you. God forgives. In return, he expects us to forgive everyone, every time, of everything, as an act of obedience and gratefulness to Jesus. How are we doing on that, guys? That should also be a part of it. That's the first benefit of being in the presence of Jesus. And what we're talking about right now is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the presence of Jesus. I talked to Lego about this. I said, I'm just convinced of that because we know that the Father is in heaven and his Son sits on the right side of the throne in heaven. But we have the Holy Spirit here. That's his presence. The second benefit that I want to bring to our attention because of the Holy Spirit, because of the presence of Jesus, is liberation and freedom. Now, these oftentimes are used together, but I found out one big difference is one has to do with being set free from imprisonment of sin, and the other one, well, you don't always get to keep it unless you work to maintain it. This is what it says. Being set free from the bondage of sin and staying free is different than just being set free. So let's look at these 2 scriptures. Luke 4. We're talking about liberation and freedom, a benefit of being in the presence of Jesus. Starting in verse 14, Luke 4. It says, "Then Jesus returned to Galilee, filled with the Holy Spirit's power. Reports about him spread quickly through the whole region. He taught regularly in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to the village of Nazareth, his boyhood home, he went as usual to the synagogue on the Sabbath and he stood up to read the scriptures. The scroll of Isaiah the prophet was handed to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where this was written. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, that the blind will see, that the oppressed will be set free, and the time of the Lord's favor has come. How many in the room have experienced liberation, being set free from the captive of sin? How many of us are remaining free? I mean, it's only possible if we're finding as many opportunities as possible to be in the presence of Jesus. Galatians 5. I'm going to read three verses, starting in verse 13. This is what the Word of God says about remaining free. It says, "For you have been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters. But don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another in love. For the whole law can be summed up in this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. But if you are always biting and devouring one another, watch out. Be aware of destroying one another." The next benefit: healing. Anybody experience healing in their life? I've been healed for some things I didn't think even Jesus was capable of healing me from. When I met him for the first time in a real way. Now, I knew about Jesus. See, I grew up in a local church. I knew his name. I knew what it looked like for my parents to experience the presence of Jesus. But I just didn't get it myself. But when I met Jesus, man, I was probably the most heartbroken, depressed person you could ever imagine. I said this a lot, but I was completely convinced I would spend the rest of my life in misery without hope, staring at a wall in my bedroom with the lights off, not wanting anyone to come in there because it was too shameful of how broken I was. And I thought, well, I'm sure Jesus can heal me from this issue with drugs, but I don't know if I'll ever be able to be okay with not having specific relationships in my life. Man, and he really proved me wrong in that part too. Jesus filled every void and every broken part of me. And he was the love that I never knew, because it was real and it was genuine. And as we'll see here shortly, he's starting to fix all the things that I was holding on to and putting in front of him as well. So we've experienced healing. This is a lifetime process. And it occurs only through the sovereign grace of God and through faith in Jesus and empowerment of the Holy Spirit. There's some of us sitting in here in the room right now that have experienced healing from Jesus, and they still need to experience more. He's going to continue to heal us of our iniquities, of our sin, of our brokenness, and he's going to continue to restore us until the day he returns. Malachi chapter 4. This is one of the last words that we hear in the Old Testament before we get into the New Testament and Jesus shows up on the scene. It was predicted before he arrived. Listen to what it says. Malachi chapter 4. The Lord of heaven's army says, "The day of judgment is coming, burning like a furnace. On that day, the arrogant and the wicked will be burned up like straw. They will be consumed, roots, branches, and all. But for you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in his wings, and you will go free, leaping with joy like calves led out to pasture. On the day when I act, you will tread upon the wicked as if they were dust under your feet, says the Lord of heaven's armies." And he says, "Remember to obey the law of Moses, my servant, all the decrees and regulations that I gave him on Mount Sinai for all Israel. And then he says, look, I'm sending you the prophet Elijah before the great and dreadful day of the Lord arrives. His preaching will turn the hearts of fathers to their children and the hearts of children to their fathers. Otherwise, I will come and strike the land with a curse. The Son brings healing. The presence of Jesus, the presence of the Holy Spirit brings healing. Benefit number four, transformation. Anybody been transformed by the presence of Jesus? That's also a lifelong process. It will continue to happen. Transformation. This is a change of our very nature, or a change at the heart of who we are. It's only available in the presence of Jesus. It's only available through the power of the Holy Spirit. You can't find these benefits anywhere else. If we've experienced these, we have a clarity on what we're talking about. Let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Let's look at verse 7. Talking about transformation. Listen, the old way, which laws etched in stone led to death, though it began with such glory that the people of Israel could not bear to look at Moses' face, for his face shone with the glory of God, even though the brightness was already fading away. Shouldn't we expect far greater glory under the new way, now that the Holy Spirit is giving life? If the old way, which brings condemnation, was glorious, how much more glorious is the new way, which makes us right with God? In fact, that first glory was not glorious at all compared with the overwhelming glory of the new way. So if the old way, which has been replaced, was glorious, how much more glorious is this new, which remains forever? Since this new way gives us such confidence, we can be very bold. We are not like Moses, who put a veil over his face so the people of Israel would not see the glory, even though it was destined to fade away. But the people's minds were hardened. And to this day, whenever the old covenant is being read, the same veil covers their minds so they cannot understand the truth. And this veil can be removed only by believing in Christ, only by believing in Jesus. Yes, even today, when they read Moses' writings, their hearts are covered with that veil and they do not understand. But whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. For the Lord is the Spirit. And wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So all of us who have had that veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like Him as we are changed into His glorious image. Transformation happens the more we're in the presence of Jesus, the more we have an opportunity to be made like Jesus. Let's talk about restoration. Another benefit that we can experience in the presence of Jesus. Anybody experienced restoration? Man, this one was good. I was looking it up. How about this for restoration? To receive back more that has been lost, to the point where the final state is greater than the original condition. Anybody ever heard of Job? He lost everything. How was he restored? Oh, he was given back double. Right? The Lord gave him a double blessing. That's what we have to look forward to, too. There may be some things that we lost. The majority of the time when we lose things, it's because we didn't take the responsibility of being grateful for the blessings that Jesus gave us. We broke them ourselves. Our sin broke them. As we talk about restoration, I want to look at 1 Peter 5. Jesus says there's restoration to look forward to in his presence. He said there might be some suffering that comes a little bit before that, though. Verses 10 and 11. In his kindness, God called you to share in his eternal glory by means of Christ Jesus. So after you have suffered a little while, he will restore, support, and strengthen you. And he will place you on a firm foundation. All power to him forever. Amen. Anybody experience the love of Jesus? His loving kindness. I'm able to find that in his presence in two different ways. His mercy and his grace. I've experienced both. See, mercy. Jesus shows us his mercy by withholding the things that we actually deserve. And he shows us his grace by offering the things that we never could deserve. His love and the presence of the Holy Spirit is what changes us. Let's look at Titus. Titus 3. I'm going to start in verse 3 in chapter 3 of Titus. We're talking about his love and his kindness. It says, once we too were foolish and disobedient. We were misled and became slaves to many lusts and pleasures. Our lives were full of evil and envy, and we hated each other. But when God, our Savior, revealed his kindness and love, he saved us not because of the righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He washed away our sins, giving us a new birth and a new life through the Holy Spirit, through his presence. He generously poured out the Spirit upon us through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Because of his grace, he made us right in his sight and gave us confidence that we will inherit eternal life. Now, all of these benefits lead up to this one thing, and that's salvation. It's all part of salvation. If we've truly been saved and we truly had a real encounter with the presence of Jesus and we put our trust and faith in him, his death and resurrection on the cross, we can now have the privilege of coming into the presence of God, which we could have never had apart from Jesus Christ. Salvation. Here's what I'm going to say. I know there's people in here that have experienced salvation from Jesus. And I know that there's some people that are here because they want to. And we're all at different places in our walks with Christ. We've experienced his presence more than others sometimes. We need to remember that all of these benefits are because of the presence of Jesus. And if we've been people who've experienced forgiveness, liberation and freedom, healing, transformation, restoration, loving kindness and salvation, we got to figure out a way to bring others into the presence of Jesus so they can too. Jesus looks at everyone in this room and he says, I want you to know me and I want you to experience the power of the Holy Spirit. So we got to stop being selfish with our salvation. And we'll get to some easy specific ways that Jesus has taught me over the past 6, 7, 8 months to be thinking the way he thinks. Be on mission with him and to bring the presence of Jesus to other people, okay? Remember, the Spirit alone gives life. Human effort accomplishes nothing. That's what it says in John 6:63. So we desperately need his presence. Or once again, we're no different than the world. Only his presence will set us apart. Jesus knew this. We'll look at John 14, and then we'll look at an Old Testament example of how this has always been the truth. As God knew this, Moses knew this. We'll look at Moses and the disciples both coming to this place saying, hold on. What do you mean you're going somewhere else? Like, they no longer wanted to be a part of this world. They wanted to be set free. They wanted to experience these benefits of being in the presence of God. So we'll look at John 14. And then we'll move and look at some scripture in Exodus, guys. Remember what we're talking about, the presence of God, and that being where life is found. This is what Jesus said, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I'll come and get you, so that you will always be with me where I am. And you know the way to where I'm going." "No, we don't know, Lord," Thomas said. "We have no idea where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus told him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. If you had really known me, you would know who my Father is. But from now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father and we will be satisfied." And Jesus replied, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and yet you still don't know who I am? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. So why are you asking me to show him to you? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words I speak are not my own, but the Father who lives in me does his work through me. Just believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. Or at least believe because of the work you have seen me do." Jesus said, "I tell you the truth, anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done, and even greater works, because I am going to be with the Father. You can ask for anything in my name, and I will do it, so that the Son can bring glory to the Father. Yes, ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it." And then he says, "If you love me, obey my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate who will never leave you. He is the Holy Spirit, who leads into all truth. See, the world cannot receive him because it isn't looking for him and doesn't recognize him. But you know him, because he lives with you now and later will be in you. No, I will not abandon you as orphans. I will come to you. Soon the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Since I live, you also will live. And when I am raised to life again, you will know that I am in the Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. And those who accept my commandments and obey them are the ones who love me. And because they love me, my Father will love them. And I will love them and reveal myself to each of them." We can find him if we search for him. He wants us to be in his presence. He doesn't want us to be out here roaming around like orphans all alone like the world. I'm always drawn to the scripture. I don't remember exactly where it is. It says Jesus had compassion on people because he looked at them and he seen they were like a sheep without a shepherd. Man, we should have the same heart as Jesus as we look around here. We've been given such an opportunity and such a platform to experience the presence of Jesus and to usher other people into his presence. If we care about people the way Jesus cares about people, we'll want them to experience the benefits of his presence. Exodus 33. Verse 12. One day Moses said to the Lord, says, "You have been telling me, take these people up to the promised land. But you haven't told me whom you will send with me. You have told me, I know you by name, and I look favorably on you." He said, "If this is true, that you look favorably on me. Let me know your ways so I may understand you more fully and continue to enjoy your favor. And remember, this nation is your very own people. The Lord replied, I will personally go with you, Moses, and I will give you rest. Everything will be fine for you. Then Moses said, if you don't personally go with us, don't make us leave this place. How will anyone know that you look favorably on me and on your people, if you don't go with us? For your presence among us sets your people and me apart from all other people on the earth. The Lord replied to Moses, I will indeed do what you have asked for. I look favorably on you and I know you by name. Moses responded, then show me your glorious presence. The Lord replied, I will make all my goodness pass before you and I will call out my name, Yahweh, before you. For I will show mercy to anyone I choose and I will show compassion to anyone I choose. But you may not look directly at my face. For no one may see me and live. The Lord continued, look, stand near me on this rock as my glorious presence passes by. Oh, I will hide you in the crevice of the rock and cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will remove my hand and let you see me from behind, but my face will not be seen. See, Moses knew that's where life was found. Moses knew without the presence of God, there was no reason to even ask him to go. I wonder if we feel the same. Are we drifting off into places where we're starting to do things in our own strength that we recognize that our efforts will be wasted if we're not experiencing the presence of Jesus and being led by the Holy Spirit? So here's where I want to switch focus. I want to switch our focus to others. I've hit on it a little bit. But I saw a lot of hands go up when I said, have you experienced forgiveness, freedom? Have you experienced healing, transformation, restoration, the love and kindness of God? Have you experienced salvation? Do you recognize that it was only because you were in the presence of the Holy Spirit that those things took place? If the presence of Jesus has changed us, certainly it'll change others. So how can we consistently bring others into his presence? Everyone in this room personally knows people whose lives and eternities depend on experiencing the presence of Jesus. They need forgiveness. They need to be liberated and set free from sin and experience the freedom that comes with the Holy Spirit. They need healing. I know people whose bones are aching because they're living in sin. And that may sound funny, but that's biblical. I know people who are breaking down physically because they haven't experienced the presence of Jesus and they haven't chose to remain there. They need transformation. They need restoration. They need Jesus and the presence of the Holy Spirit. Here's what I know. Loving Jesus with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength isn't just about loving Jesus. It's about being transformed so we can be people who love Judas. These people need Jesus. There's nothing special about us that we're sitting here raised to new life, man, that Jesus can't do with everyone we know before it's too late. The Word of God says to seek Jesus while he may still be found. Like right now, he's still available to be found. What are we doing to help other people experience his presence? We know some people that maybe we could look back in the past and say, man, I know they were experiencing the presence of Jesus, but now we're not so sure. We've had some people leave our local church. And I just want to encourage you with this, man. Never, ever lose hope. Just keep finding ways to bring people into the presence of Jesus. We plant, we water. Others plant, others water. Jesus makes things grow. The only reason we can stand here right now and say that we've experienced these benefits of the Holy Spirit is because Jesus caused things to change. And there were people in our lives who were faithful to point out the necessity of being in the presence of Jesus for those things to take place. We need to be the same thing. How can we not feel the obligation to pass on what we've received? Never lose hope for these people, man. Jesus makes things grow. Trust that he's going to do his part. The question is, are we? We're a part of the church. We weren't saved just for us. We were saved so other people could come to know Jesus through knowing us and experiencing Jesus' presence. This should be the passion of every believer. So let's look at a few things that we can do to put us in a better position to bring people into the presence of Jesus, okay? And the first one is we got to be in his presence ourselves. No one's going to encounter me not filled with the presence of Jesus and be brought into the presence of Jesus. Does that make sense? I got nothing to offer. We have to pull people into his presence. We can't push people into the presence of God. Does that make sense? We got to be living our lives in such a way that people are drawn to us. Jesus said we're the salt of the earth. We talked about this recently. Amanda was talking to me about it, I think. Jesus says, man, in Scripture, our conversations should be attractive and gracious. He's talking about having our conversations being flavored with salt. The things we say, the things that we talk about, is it making people thirsty for Jesus? If it's not, then we're giving people, bringing people into our own presence. And that's not going to change anyone. I would have been changed a long, long time ago if it was about my presence. My sinful butt's always been there. But Jesus is what changes people. We cannot manipulate or shame anyone into the presence of Jesus. I'm just picking up on where Lego started last week. Jesus has got us on the same page here, and he's trying to show us his heart so we can be more like him. We haven't always done that, but we're still breathing, so he still wants to bring us into his presence so we can experience these benefits. Listen, man, as people see us in the presence of God, and their hearts will be drawn in. That's what Jesus says. Another simple way. Are we praising Jesus in front of people? Is that what people see when they see us? They see us praising Jesus. It's probably the quickest way to enter into God's presence is through praise. Praising the Lord will increase your thankfulness and activate the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. We have so many things to be thankful for. Think back, everyone was raising their hand as we were talking about these benefits. How often are we praising Jesus for these things, knowing that we would not have them apart from him? Other people would be pulled in to the presence of Jesus, and we'll be making room for them to do that through our praise. Next thing, we got to focus on Jesus and what he is doing. Fixing our thoughts on the champion who initiated our faith and what his mission is. The Holy Spirit will lead us and help us. But if we are clear on Jesus' mission being for as many people as possible to encounter him and be changed and to be brought into a right relationship with God before it's too late, if our mission is anything but that, we're not aligned with the will of God. His mission, to seek and save the lost, to make all things new. This is what it looks like to be kingdom-minded. As I look around, Jesus is teaching me and he's teaching you guys what it looks like to care about others. And he's teaching us what it looks like to be thinking about the things that he's thinking about. He's thinking about making all things new. Every opportunity you're able to visibly see, because that's why we have eyes, that's why we have ears, so we can be alert and aware to what the Holy Spirit wants us to do. That's why we have minds. It's not just for us. It's for the benefit and the purpose of Jesus. We should be thinking about what needs to be made new, Jesus. I want to be a part of where you are. That's what he's doing. We should be taking every opportunity that comes along for us to be a part of what he's doing now. Next thing is we got to stop thinking about all the negative things. We got to stop focusing on these things. This is behavior management. It's a difference between recognizing a sin issue and solely focusing on it. Focusing on the negative. But we should be focusing on the solution. And that's Jesus and his presence. That's what Jesus focused on. Saving people. You see, Satan focuses on the negative. The devil will always remind us that we're not worthy to be saved. And he's right. But let me tell you what Jesus focuses on. This is what Jesus focuses on. He says this in Matthew 11. Come to me, all you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart. And you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light. How many times are we focusing on the solution? And how many times are we focusing on the problem? Recognize the problem, shift focus to the solution. That's what Jesus says. The next thing we need to do is to speak the truth of the word. We can't speak the truth of the word if we don't know the word. Jesus says you'll know the truth and the truth will set you free. He's talking about this, having it written on your heart. This is what will change you from everyone else. This is what will let us know that what we thought was true is not. Jesus makes it very clear. But it can't just be the truth. Truth that isn't motivated out of love and empowered by the Holy Spirit isn't going to change anyone. Our words and heart combined with the Holy Spirit's presence is an open invitation for others to enter into the presence of God. When we take the word to people and we're aware of opportunities to speak truth into people's lives, and we're doing it because we love them and we want them to experience all the benefits of his presence, the Holy Spirit certainly wants the same thing. When we line up doing the things that we already know the Holy Spirit wants to do, we'll meet him right there. And something amazing will take place that we aren't able to accomplish apart from that. You know what the next one is, man? We need to have fun. This is awesome. This is the greatest, most incredible, joyful thing I have ever been a part of, ever. We have fun at Worcester. I promise you we do. Sometimes too much fun. It's not all, sometimes maybe it's simple. All right, so I apologize, Jesus, but this is fun. Dude, this is awesome being a part of discipleship. In God's presence, in the presence of the Holy Spirit, the fullness of joy is found. Man, people look around and they see us having a great time, pursuing Jesus together in unity. Dude, it's attractive. It's an attractive thing to display to others. So are we representing his joy and the delight of his presence? People will be drawn to the goodness of God, and they'll want to enter into his presence. Because if they don't have that joy and that clear, evident, man, this is a good time. Why would it be desirable for them if they see us just walking around being miserable all the time? There ain't nothing better. I've done some things that a lot of people would consider fun. It's never been like this. This comes with purpose. And the last thing we could do, man, to bring people into the presence of Jesus is, we got to be people who aren't selfish. We got to motivate other people to acts of love. I'm going to look at two scriptures here. Let's look at Philippians 2. Two verses, verse 3 and 4. This scripture tripped me up real bad for a long time because I was struggling trying to figure it out. This is what it says. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out for only your own interests, but take an interest in others too. So here's where I struggled with the scripture for a long time. I was like, man, I can think of, all right, it's easy for me to think of some people as being better than myself, but man, when I look at this person, it's hard for me to do that. You guys ever felt that way? Well, luckily Jesus has all these benefits that come in his presence because he's also changed my heart too. But this is what I started to understand. See, we're so surface level, we're so simple with our understanding of the word. I mean, we don't even typically cry out to the Holy Spirit for understanding. We just think we've already made it. We just start reading. But this is what Jesus is teaching me. When it says, man, be humble, thinking of others is better than yourselves. Don't look out only for your own interest, but take an interest in others too. One of the greatest lessons Jesus ever taught me was this. Stop worrying about your own relationship with me so much. You're a consumer. You can follow me and bring other people with you to do that. Bring other people along to experience the presence of Jesus. Are you concerned about other people's eternity as much as you are your own? If we were honest, a lot of us would struggle to say, yeah, I am. Don't look out only for your own interests, but for the interests in others too. You think Jesus is concerned with the eternity of others? I do too. When you switch your perspective to being just as concerned about other people being in the presence of Jesus as you being in the presence of Jesus, let me explain something to you. Guess who gets to be there? Both of you. Right? You bring someone else into the presence of Jesus, you'll be there too. It ain't always just about the selfish outlook where I want to experience Jesus. Bring other people into the presence of Jesus. You're not going to miss out. Where you will miss out is the selfish focus all the time. And some of us are still trying to get there. I get that. But you know where life is found? Is sharing what Jesus is doing with you with other people. Switching your focus from yourself to other people. Jesus is faithful to take care of you too in that moment, I promise you. Now let's look at this other side. Don't motivating others to acts of love. Hebrews 10. Hebrews 10, verse 24. It says, let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. And now, that brings us to the book of Philippians. Took me a while. This is why this book is so close to my heart. All the things we've talked about, all the benefits of being in Jesus' presence can be found in this one little chapter. All the things that we talked about that we could do to bring people into the presence of Jesus will be found in this one little chapter. And let me tell you why. The Apostle Paul experienced the presence of Jesus in a real powerful way. And he was never the same again. The Apostle Paul experienced forgiveness, liberation, freedom. He experienced healing, transformation, restoration, the loving kindness of Jesus. He experienced salvation through the cross. And it was so good, he wanted other people to experience it too. We got a story about a slave named Onesimus. See, here's something that's really, really awesome about the love and the presence of Jesus. You got more options than just what this world tells you you have. Back when this book was going on, back when this slave ran away, it was a responsibility of people who found that slave to turn him in. Turn him into the law. He ran away from where he belonged. Paul knew there was other options. What he did was, instead of following the law, he decided to bring Onesimus into the presence of Jesus. And you can see clearly that Onesimus wasn't very useful at one point. Oh, but that changed. But that wasn't enough for Paul. Paul also knew Philemon. He had worked with him before. They had experienced the presence of Jesus together. And Paul was thinking of ways to motivate people to acts of love and wasn't just thinking of himself, but he was thinking about the needs and the interests of others too. So this is what it says. This letter is for Paul, a prisoner for preaching the good news about Jesus Christ, and from our brother Timothy. I am writing to Philemon, our beloved co-worker, and to his sister Aphia, and to our fellow soldier Archippus, and to the church that meets in your house. May God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ give you grace and peace. Paul said, I always thank my God when I pray for you, Philemon, because I keep hearing about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all of God's people. And I am praying that you will put into action the generosity that comes from your faith as you understand and experience all the good things we have in Christ. Your love has given me much joy and comfort, my brother, for your kindness has often refreshed the hearts of God's people. Oh, Paul was slick. Paul understood the scripture that says to be as shrewd as a snake, but as harmless as a dove. What do you think happened when Philemon opened this letter and started reading that first paragraph? He was like, oh, thanks, Paul. But then here we go. He's like, put your faith into action. I'm going to remind you about Jesus. I'm going to do what I can from a distance, bring you into the presence of Jesus. And then I'm going to remind you of the truth. And I'm going to give you an opportunity to experience it further. That is why I'm boldly asking a favor of you. Paul said, I could demand it in the name of Christ because it's the right thing for you to do. But because of our love, I prefer simply to ask you. Consider this a request from me, Paul, an old man, and now also a prisoner for the sake of Christ Jesus. He said, I appeal to you to show kindness to my child, Onesimus. I became his father in the faith while here in prison. Onesimus hasn't been of much use to you in the past, but now he's very useful to both of us. I am sending him back to you, and with him comes my own heart. See, Paul was putting these two people, Philemon, Onesimus, an old slave who had ran away, probably stole some things. He was bringing them both into the presence of Jesus so they could experience these benefits. I wanted to keep him here with me while I am in these chains for preaching the good news, and he would have helped me on your behalf. But I didn't want to do anything without your consent. I wanted you to help because you were willing, not because you were forced. It seems you lost Onesimus for a little while so that you could have him back forever. He is no longer like a slave to you. He is more than a slave. For he is a beloved brother, especially to me. Now he will mean much more to you both as a man and a brother in the Lord. So, if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge it to me. I, Paul, write this with my own hand. I will repay it. And I won't mention that you owe me your very soul. Yes, my brother, please do me this favor. He doesn't say for his sake, but he says for the Lord's sake. Give me this encouragement in Christ. I'm confident as I write this letter that you will do what I ask and even more. And one more thing. Please prepare a guest room for me, for I am hoping that God will answer your prayers and let me return to you soon. Epaphras, Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends you his greetings. So do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my co-workers. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Man, this book of Philemon just screams the cross. It's about forgiveness. It's about restoration. It's about freedom. It's about transformation. It's about heart change. It's about being in the presence of Jesus. It's about continuing to experience the goodness of salvation through Jesus Christ. It's about putting our faith into action. Before we pray, I want everyone to be reminded that we aren't just rescued out of something. We are now rescued into a life of faith, a life of action for the purpose of Jesus and for his kingdom. It's time to get to work, and it starts, lines up with caring about the same things that Jesus cares about. I don't know how well we're doing at that, but I know we can do better. And I know we've experienced all these magnificent benefits that all are part of salvation. Because that's just who Jesus is. And if he'd be willing to do that for us, he'd certainly be willing to do that for others. They just need to experience his presence. Let's pray.